Thank you, and thank you all for joining us today. I'm here to present some information about the Rhodes Scholarship. I serve as the co-secretary for the Rhodes Scholarships in South Australia. My colleague John Williams at the University of Adelaide also serves as co-secretary. And do keep in mind that you can feel free to reach out to us at any time throughout the application process. We do encourage that so we can help mentor you and shepherd you through this extraordinary opportunity. And the Rhodes Scholarship itself funds you to go to the University of Oxford specifically for up to 3 years, where you can do a second bachelor degree, or a master's, or a DPhil, the Oxford equivalent of a PhD. And this is a transformative opportunity because University of Oxford is one of the premier destinations in the world to do scholarship. It's regularly ranked in the top universities in the world, and it's a magnet for talented, curious, motivated people to go study many different things. Every year, we elect 9 Australian Rhodes Scholars. This is an international scholarship. So I was a US Rhodes Scholar, and I was at Oxford from 2006 to 2011. There are more than 100 Rhodes Scholars every year elected that will join you at Oxford. This is part of a tradition that started in 1903. The first Australians that were Rhodes Scholars enrolled in 1904. And this is funded by the endowment bestowed by Cecil Rhodes according to his will. You'll join a community of nearly 8,000 Rhodes Scholars worldwide, and that network, I would argue, is priceless. And it's one of the joys when I get a cold call from people in that network who are seeking advice, and it's very valuable to myself personally when I can seek advice from this cohort of Rhodes Scholars around the world. So a little bit about the nuts and bolts of this. We award 6 Rhodes Scholarships in each of the states, and then there is a second round, the at-large round, where applicants from the territories apply, and also the second and third candidates from the state. So we can elect one scholar. We will elect one scholar from South Australia, and then we nominate up to 2 to have a second go. Each year, we typically have between 10 and 20 applicants. So the odds are not too bad. The UniSA has had 2 Rhodes Scholars in its history, but we haven't had an applicant from UniSA for 2 years. And so I'm here to encourage you to apply, to reach out and talk to me to help help you along in that process, because it is attainable. Like I said before, we will award one, and we typically have no more than 20 people apply for this prestigious scholarship. Regarding eligibility, you must be an Australian citizen, and you must have lived in Australia for at least 2 of the last 10 years. You must have completed at least 2 years of your high school or secondary schooling here in Australia. You must have completed your honors or master's degree, and you need to earn a first-class honors or equivalent mark of distinction. And so for this upcoming round, I'm addressing primarily those who are finishing your honors or master's or who have recently finished those degrees, and also the second and third year undergraduates, so you can start preparing to be competitive for this in the coming years. There is an age restriction for the Rhodes Scholarship, so you must be at least 19, but you must be less than 26 years old. And you can only apply for the Rhodes Scholarship twice. And so what are we looking for in the selection process? Like many of the scholarships you hear about today, academic excellence is the first and foremost criteria. And so we're looking for students who are curious and motivated to discover things, whether that be in the lab, in history, or whatever type of whatever field you're interested in. Okay? But academic excellence is a very important part of the application. To give you an idea of GPA, typically 6.75 is the cutoff. And the reason for that is you have to be admitted to the University of Oxford. So you need to be competitive not only for the scholarship, but you need to be admitted to both the university and the college that you would be affiliated with. The second criteria is that we want you to use your energy to develop your talent to the fullest. And historically, that meant being involved in sporting activities of some sort. But now it's much more general than that. It's using your energy to do not just athletics, but music, art, or whatever other creative endeavor that you're passionate about. We're interested in applicants who exhibit truth, courage, devotion to duty, sympathy and protection for the weak, and those who will go out and fight the world's fight. And that is connected to the criteria for leadership as well. And we do take these attributes of applicants quite seriously. There is no one formula for a Rhodes Scholar. They come in all shapes and forms and walks of life. And so I want to convey that this is accessible, and we are working to draw upon the talent pool that certainly is spread across all of the universities here in South Australia and across the state. And we really want you to come and speak to us if this is an opportunity that you want to pursue. We'll help you get your application in and put your best foot forward. Where can you apply? So you apply in the state or territory in which you've completed your most recent degree, usually an honors or master's, or where you did the majority of your secondary schooling. So last year, for instance, we had all of the applicants from University of Adelaide, but we also had applicants from University of New South Wales because they were from South Australia originally, and this is where they did their secondary schooling. If you're studying overseas, you'll apply in the state or territory in which you attended high school or secondary school. And if you're applying from the territories, you'll apply for the territory round, and you'll compete against the at-large candidates. All of the application process is completed online. If you have any questions throughout the application process, you can contact me directly. You can message me, call me, direct message me on Twitter. We have access to this to help shepherd this through. So if there's any technical issues or if you have any questions, don't hesitate to reach out. Everything will open on the 1st of July and will close on the 13th of September. The application itself will go through some of these nuts and bolts. The all-important personal statement, a 1,000-word document that you'll submit that introduces yourself to the panel. What are your passions? What are your interests? What experience prepares you to go to Oxford, and why Oxford specifically will help develop and nurture your unique talents and ambitions to fight the world's fight. You'll submit a CV. It's up to 3 pages, so you have an opportunity to show the different types of achievements and provide some context for the level of those achievements. And you're required to submit 5 letters. That's reduced from 1 in previous years. Historically, we required 6 referee reports, and this year we only require 5. For those of you who aren't applying this year but are considering this in the future years, keep that in mind. That's quite a few letters to obtain. It's important to reach out to academic mentors and cultivate relationships so they can be your advocates, so they can help put you in a position to succeed. I can't stress enough the importance of strong letters. At least 3 of those letters must be from an academic mentor or someone who can attest to your level of academic attainment. And the other 2 letters can be from anywhere, as long as they address the selection criteria. And then we'll also ask for birth certificates, passports, and official transcripts. If you're intending on doing a DPhil, a PhD at Oxford, you'll also be required to submit a 2-page research statement that explains what you intend to do in your research. And that includes a summary, some background or context to the research problems that you'll work on, how you will do that, the value to your area, your discipline, and society at large, and your proposed department and potential supervisors. And I would strongly encourage you to make contact before you apply with prospective mentors at Oxford. So like we said before, everything opens in July. Once that closes in September, we start shortlisting candidates. The interviews are already scheduled for the end of November. We'll invite you for a lunch on the first day, and then the following day we will complete the interviews. We elect 1 Rhodes Scholar from South Australia, and we nominate up to 2 for the at-large round. And last year, we elected one scholar at the state level, and then one of the at-large nominees also won a scholarship. So 2 Rhodes Scholars were elected from South Australia last year. And so what does the scholarship entail? So it pays for all of the international fees for Oxford, so that's quite a lucrative scholarship. In addition, it pays for a living stipend, which is just over 15,000 pounds per year, and that's up to 3 years. Okay, and so if you're intending on doing a DPhil that can sometimes stretch to 4 years, it's important that you point out to your supervisor that in that fourth year you will have to secure funding from other sources. But usually there are ways to work around that. But the Rhodes Scholarship will only fund, very strictly, 3 years of study at Oxford. They'll also pay for flights to and from the UK, and the scholarship cannot be deferred, and it cannot be held with any other scholarships. Like I said, Rhodes Scholars come in all shapes and sizes and walks of life. They're Nobel Prize winners, leaders in medicine and science, and government. They're Olympians, university leaders, business leaders. They lead NGOs, Pulitzer Prize winners. They work in the justice system and in the media. But you know, for every high-flying Rhodes Scholar that's very visible in the media, you have thousands of others that work and live here in South Australia, for instance. So this is something that is attainable. The Rhodes Network and opportunities are one of the most attractive parts of this scholarship. They support your academic development. There are many types of invited lectures that you can go to at Rhodes House. You become part of a global network where you can be mentored or mentor other Rhodes Scholars. They have many retreats, allied scholar events. You will be invited to many recruiting opportunities. For instance, the big consulting firms and tech companies will seek out Rhodes Scholars to employ. So there's no shortage of opportunities. Oxford itself is similar in many ways to Cambridge, as you heard from Taruna. Oxford's made up of 43 self-governing, financially independent colleges. You can see some photos here. So it's quite a romantic place. If you do a second undergraduate degree, the college is where you do your tutorials. So you'll work with academics, and typically your cohort in a college is no more than six people in your area of study. The colleges have accommodation. They have the formal dinners and social events, and many of them provide financial support, scholarships for travel and academic conferences and other activities and sporting events. There are about 10,000 postgraduates at Oxford. The majority of them come from outside the UK. So it's truly an international destination and a magnet for people from all over the world, like I said, that are curious and motivated to do world-leading scholarship. In my own time there, I'm somewhere up in this photo, one of the hallmarks of doing research in Oxford for 5 years was the many interesting people that I met from all over the world. And just in that single research group, I had the privilege of working with people from more than 30 countries. So that's not even in the department, that's in a single research group. So it's quite a remarkable place to study. Oxford is quite charming in many ways. You can go have a meal in the Eagle and Child, where Tolkien and C.S. Lewis discuss the next piece of writing they're working on. You can punt down the river if you're more competitive. Rowing is a very popular thing to do in Oxford and Cambridge as well. The picture on the top right here is New College, where I lived for a couple years. It was built in 1389. So it's anything but new. You can see the inside of this. Taruna talked about the Harry Potter experience. Actually, much of Harry Potter was actually filmed here at Oxford, at New College, in fact. And since we're convening here in the Hawk Building, the Turf Tavern, just on the bottom left, which is just outside of New Colleges, where Bob Hawke purportedly set the world record for downing a yard of beer. So many interesting cultural aspects to Oxford. So I think I'll leave it at that. I'll thank you. If you're considering applying, or if you know someone who is talented, motivated, and wants to study at one of the best institutions in the world, please tap them on the shoulder and send them my way. I have many collaborations here at UniSA, so I'm in the city frequently. I'm happy to meet up. We can have a coffee and discuss how you can prepare your application. My contact details are here. You're also very welcome to contact my colleague, John Williams, at the University of Adelaide, the co-secretary, and we're looking forward to receiving your applications. Thank you very much.